أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ما كان محمد أبا أحد من رجالكم ولكن رسول الله وخاتم النبيين وكان الله بكل شيء عليما بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. The respected people on the dais, the chairperson, Janab Haji Muhammad Hashim Sahib, the Prince of our court, the chairman of SIIT College, the honorary secretary, the respected elders, and my dear brothers and sisters. I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, blessings, and mercy of Almighty Allah be on all of you. The topic of this evening's talk is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the various religious scriptures of the world. Many people have the misconception that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the founder of the religion of Islam. In fact, Islam is there since time immemorial. It's there since man set foot on the earth. And the Holy Quran says in Surah Fatir, chapter number 35, verse number 24, it says, وَإِمْ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا حَلَى فِيهَا نَزِيرٍ. There is not a nation or a tribe to whom we have not sent a warner or a guide. The Quran says in Surah Rod, chapter number 13, verse number 7, وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ. And to every nation we have sent a warner. By name, the Holy Quran mentions 25 messengers by name. For example, Adam, Moses, Jesus, Solomon, Muhammad, peace be upon them all. But according to the tradition of a beloved prophet, there were more than 124,000 messengers sent on the face of the earth. The Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse number 164, as well as in Surah Ghafir, chapter number 40, verse number 78, that we relate to you the stories of some of the messengers, of the others we don't. That means, some messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have been mentioned in the Holy Quran, the others have not been mentioned. All the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of God Almighty, that came before Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they were only meant for a particular group of people. They were only sent for a particular group of people. And the message which they brought was only meant for a particular time period. It was not till eternity. The Holy Quran says that Musa alayhi salam, Moses, peace be upon him, he was only sent for the Bani Israel, for the children of Israel. The Quran says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 49, that Jesus, peace be upon him, was sent as a messenger to the Bani Israel, to the children of Israel. He was only sent for the Jews. A similar message is given in the Bible, in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 10, verse number 5 to 6, where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, tells his disciples, his apostles, that go ye not into the way of the Gentiles. Who are the Gentiles? The non-Jews. Go ye not into the way of the Gentiles, and enter ye not into the city of the Samaritans, but rather go to the house of the lost sheep of Israel. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 15, verse number 24, that I have not been sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was only sent for the Jews. But the Holy Quran says, and I started my talk by quoting a verse of the Holy Quran from Surah Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 40, which says, Ma kana Muhammadun aba ahadim min rijalikum, walakin Rasulullah wa khatamun nabiyyin wa kana Allahu bi kulli shay'in alima. That Muhammad, peace be upon him, is not the father of any of you men, but is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And is Khatmun Nabi'een, is the seal of the prophets. And Allah is all-knowing, full of knowledge. The Holy Quran says that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the last of the prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Quran says in Surah Al-Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 107, it says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةَ لِلْعَالَمِينَ, that we have sent thee not but as a mercy to all the creatures, as a mercy to all the worlds, as a mercy to the whole of humankind. So Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he was not sent only to the Muslims or the Arabs, he was sent to the whole of humankind. The Quran says in Surah Sabah, chapter number 34, verse number 28, it says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَظِيرًا, that we have sent thee as a universal messenger, giving glad tidings to men and warning them against sin. But the most of them yet do not understand. Since the Holy Quran says that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the last and final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he was sent for the whole of humankind, all the Muslims, alhamdulillah, will agree with it. But since a non-Muslim does not believe that the Holy Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will not agree that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is a last and final prophet of God Almighty and is sent for the whole of humankind. So to make them realize this, we have to take the help of the Holy Quran, which says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 64, which says that تَعَلَوْ إِلَىٰ قَلْمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ, that come to common terms as between us and you. So since the non-Muslims will not believe in the Holy Quran, we have to prove to them about the advent of a beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, from their holy scriptures. So let's analyze today Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the various religious scriptures of the world. Let's first discuss the prophecy of a beloved Prophet in the Hindu scriptures. Amongst the Hindu scriptures, the most sacred are the Vedas. There are principally four Vedas: the Rig Ved, the Yajur Ved, the Sam Ved, and the Atharva Ved. The first three, the Rig Ved, the Yajur Ved, the Sam Ved, are known as the Triple Vidya, the Triple Sciences. And they were revealed much earlier as compared to the last Ved, that is the Atharva Ved. The Rig Ved, it deals with songs of praises. The Yajur Ved, it deals with sacrifices, formulas. The Sam Ved deals with melody. And the Atharva Ved deals with remedies and magic formulas. These Veds, according to the Hindus, they are the word of God Almighty. But they do not know exactly when were they revealed or when were they written. But most of the scholars unanimously say it was written about 4,000 years ago. The other important holy scripture of the Vedas are the Puranas. The Puranas speak about the history of the universe, the history of the Aryans, the stories of gods and deities. And these Puranas have been divided into 18 voluminous parts by Maharishi Vyas. And one amongst them is the Bhavishya Purana, the Purana speaking about Bhavishya, about the future. If you read the Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khand 3, Adhyatta 3, Shlokas 5 to 8, it says that a Malecha, a spiritual teacher, will arise with his companions. His name shall be Muhammad, peace be upon him. And Raja Bhoj, after giving this Mahadev Arab a bath in the Panchgarh and the Ganges water, he will address him with reverence and say, O pride of humankind, I pay obeisance to you. You have collected a great force against the devil, and you have been protected from the enemies. if you analyze this prophecy in the Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adheta 3, Shlokas 5 to 8, it speaks about Amalecha. Amalecha in Sanskrit means a foreigner speaking a foreign tongue. It says a foreigner speaking a foreign tongue. A spiritual leader will arise with his companions, that is the Sahabas, and his name shall be Muhammad, peace be upon him. And Raja Bhoj, after giving this Mahadev Arab a bath in the Panchgarv, that means it's an idiom saying that the person has been purified from all sins. And we know that all the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are purified. They are masooms. They are sinless. It further says that he will address him as the pride of humankind. And we know that the beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the pride of humankind. It's mentioned in Surah Al-Qalam, chapter number 68, verse number 4, that thou standest on the exalted standard of character. The Quran says in Surah Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 21, that you will find in the Messenger of Allah a beautiful pattern of conduct. And the Quran says in Surah Al-Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 107, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have sent thee not but as a mercy to the whole of humankind. If you read further in the Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adheta 3, Shlokas 10 to 27, it says that the Malechas have spoiled the land of the Arabs. Arya Dharm is not to be found there. There was a devil who, God Almighty, had destroyed earlier. But now he has been sent by a more powerful enemy. There will be a person who will be sent, who will correct the devil and put the enemies on the true path. His name shall be Muhammad, peace be upon him. And the prophecy continues that says to Raja Bhoj that you need not go to the foolish land of the Pishachas. For I, through my kindness, will purify you here itself. And a shrewd man in the form of Pishacha says that Arya Dharma will prevail in the world. Ishwar Paramatma has sent me and said that his follower will be a man who is circumcised, who will not have a tail on his head, will not have a shindi. He will sport a beard. He will create a revolution in the world. He will give the call for prayers. He will eat all lawful things. He will eat the animals but will not eat swine. He shall not be purified by the holy shrubs, that the vegetable, but will be purified by the sword. And because he will fight the irreligious people, he will be called as a Musalman. And God Almighty will start this creed of meat eaters. If you analyze this prophecy, it speaks about a devil who God Almighty had destroyed earlier. Similar to the incidents mentioned in the Holy Quran in Surah Fil, in chapter number 105, which says, Alam tara kayfa fa'ala rabbuka bi ashabil fil, alam yaj'al qaydahum fi tadlil, wa arsala alayhim khayran ababil, farmihim bihijaratin min sijil, faj'alahum kasfin ma'qul. That fear thou not how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dealt with the companions of the elephant, and let their treacherous plan go astray. And he sent against them flights of birds, striking them with stones of baked clay. And they were made to look like an empty field of straws and stalks, of whose corn had been eaten away. The prophecy says, there was a devil. The Quran speaks about Abraham and the army of elephants, who God Almighty had destroyed. This devil was destroyed, but now he has been sent by a more powerful enemy. And he will be put on the true path by a person called as Muhammad, peace be upon him. And the prophecy continues that Raja Bhoj need not go to the foolish land of the Pishachas, because when the Muslims will come to India, they will be purified by the kindness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the prophecy continues that Ishwar Paramatma says, that God Almighty, that my follower will be a man who is circumcised, who is not having a tail on the head, that is a shindi, will be keeping a beard, will create a revolution in the world, and he will give the call for prayers, that is the adhan. And the prophecy continues, he will eat all lawful things, but will not have the flesh of swine. And the Holy Quran says, in no less than four different places, in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 173, in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 3, in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 145, and Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 115, it says, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتُتُ وَالْدَّمُ وَلَحْمِ الْخِنْزِيرِ وَمَا أُحُلَّ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. That is forbidden for you for food are dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides Allah has been invoked. The Quran says the flesh of swine is prohibited. And the prophecy says the same, that these followers will not eat the flesh of swine. They will not be purified by the herbs, that the vegetable, but by warfare. And because they will fight the irreligious people, they will be called as Musalman. This prophecy refers to no one but our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. There are even prophecies given in the Vedas, especially in the Atharva Ved. There are certain chapters in the Atharva Ved known as the Kuntap Suktas. The word Kuntap means free from trouble and misery. That means a message of peace. If you translate it into Arabic, it means Islam. Kuntap also means the hidden glands in the abdomen, meaning that these verses of Atharva Ved have a hidden meaning which they'll come to know in the future. And Kuntap also means, that means the navel of the earth, the center of the earth. And the holy city of Makkah is referred to as Ummul Qura, the mother of all cities, as the center of the earth. So if you read the Kuntap Suktas, that is Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 127, verses 1 to 14, these are the Kuntap Suktas. Time does not permit us to go into the details of all the verses. I will pay emphasis to the first four verses. The first mantra says that he is Narashansa, he is Kaurama, and will be protected from 60,090 enemies. Mantra number 2 says he will be a camel riding Rishi. Mantra 3 says that he is Mahma Rishi, who has been given 100 gold coins, 10 necklaces, 300 steeds of horses, and 10,000 cows. Mantra 4 says, his Vachyavesh Rabe. If you analyze these mantras, the first mantra says, he is Narashansa. Narashansa in Sanskrit, if you translate into English, means the praised worthy. If you translate into Arabic, it means Muhammad, peace be upon him, which was the name of a beloved prophet. It also says, he is Kaurama. Kaurama means a person who is an immigrant. And a beloved prophet, Muhammad, peace be upon him, was an immigrant. He migrated from Makkah to Medina. And further says that he will be protected from 60,090 enemies. This was the approximate population of Makkah that was against our beloved prophet. Mantra number 2 says that he will be a camel riding Rishi. No Brahmin, no Indian Rishi will ride the camel, because according to the Manusmriti, chapter number 11, verse number 202, it clearly states that a Brahmin is prohibited from riding a camel or an ass. And he cannot bathe naked. He will have to suppress his breath to be purified. So, but natural, this Rishi, which the Kuntap Sukta, Atharva Ved, speak about, has to be a foreigner. Mantra number 3 says, he is Mahma Rishi. Mahma, if you translate into English, means exalted. And some of the Hindu scriptures also say he is Muhammad Rishi, peace be upon him. It further says, he has been given 100 gold coins. These 100 gold coins refer to the first 100 Sahabas of the beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, who accepted Islam and later migrated to Abyssinia and joined the Prophet in Medina. He has been given 10 necklaces. These 10 necklaces refer to the 10 people who had been promised paradise by the Prophet. It further says, he's been given 300 steeds. The Sanskrit word Arwa means an Arab horse which is very swift, an Arab steed. These 300 people, steeds, refer to the 300 companions of the Prophet who took part in the battle of Badr, who even though the enemy were thrice the number, yet they were victorious. It further says that he has been given 10,000 cows. The Sanskrit word go means cow. It also means victory. Cow is a symbol for victory and for peace, referring to the approximate 10,000 population that was along with the Prophet during Fateh Mecca, conquest of Mecca. Mantra 4 says, he is Rave. Rave, if you translate into English, means one who praises, one who prays. If you translate into Arabic, it means Ahmad, which was another name of a beloved Prophet, Muhammad, peace be upon him. So these Kuntab Suktas refer to no other personality than our beloved Prophet, Muhammad, peace be upon him. There are several prophecies in the Hindu scriptures. If you read the Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 6, it speaks about the battle of the Allies, the battle of Ahzab, and gives the description of the battle of Ahzab. The next verse of Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 7, says that, O God Almighty, you have overthrown the 20 kings and the 60,090 opponents of the praying one. The Sanskrit word Karu means the praying one. If you translate into Arabic, means Ahmad. That is the name of a beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It says that God Almighty has overthrown 20 kings. At the time of the Prophet, the Mecca had several, there were several tribes, and each tribe had their own chief. And there were approximately 20 tribes during the time of the beloved Prophet, referring to the 20 kings which were overthrown. And again, the 60,090 enemies mentioned in the Atharva Ved refers to the population of Makkah that was against our beloved Prophet. The same prophecy is also mentioned in Rig Ved, book number 1, chapter number 53, verse number 9. But the Sanskrit word used is Sushrama, which if you translate means the praiseworthy. If you translate into Arabic, means Muhammad, peace be upon him, which was the name of the beloved Prophet. Again in Psalm Ved, again the prophecy is given in book number 2, chapter number 6, verse number 8, that Ahmad will be given the divine eternal law, may peace be upon him. But natural, Ahmad is the name of the beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, who was given the Holy Quran, to whom was revealed the Holy Quran. There are several verses in the Hindu scriptures, but time does not permit us to deal with all the various prophecies of our beloved Prophet in the Hindu scriptures. Now let's discuss the prophecy of a beloved Prophet in the Parsi scriptures. Prophet Zoroaster is the prophet of the religion of Zoroastrianism or Parsiism, also known as the fire worshippers or Meganism. This religion originated about 2,500 years ago in Persia. And they have got two holy scriptures, the Dasatir and the Avesta. The Dasatir is further divided into Khurda Dasatir and Kalan Dasatir. The Avesta is further divided into Khurda Avesta and Kalan Avesta, or Zend Avesta or Mahazen. These holy scriptures of the Parsi have been written in Pahalvi and Zendi, and a few of them in the cuneiform language. There are several prophecies even in the Parsi scriptures about the advent of the beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. If you read the Zend Avesta, chapter number 28, verse number 129, which is also mentioned in the sacred books of the East, volume number 23, Zen Avesta part number 2, page number 220, it says that he is victorious. He is Soshian. His name is Astavit Areta. The Soshian, the beneficent one, will benefit the whole of humankind. The Astavit Areta, being a bodily creature, will fight against the evil of the humankind and will fight against the drug of the two-footed brute. If you analyze this prophecy, it says that he is victorious. And we know our beloved prophet was victorious during Fateh Mecca. It says he is Soshian. Soshian, according to the Hastings Encyclopedia, it means praiseworthy, which if you translate into Arabic means Muhammad, peace be upon him. It further says his name will be Astavit Areta. Astavit Areta has been derived from the Sanskrit word Astu, meaning one who prays, one who praises, or by sitar down, the Persian word, which means the praying one, which if you translate into Arabic means Ahmad, which was another name of a beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It further says that he will benefit the whole of humankind. And Quran says in Surah Al-Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 107, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, that we have sent thee not but as the mercy to the whole of humankind. The prophecy further says that he will be Astavit Areta, who will fight against the evil of the humankind and will fight against the drug of the two-footed brute. And we know that our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, fought against the evil of the humankind. If you further read in the Zend Avesta, Zamyad Yasht, chapter number 16, verse number 95, also mentioned in the sacred books of the East, volume 23, Zend Avesta part 2, page number 308, it says that his friends, the friends of Astavit Areta, they will be against the devil. They will be well thinking, well hearing, well seeing, and will have good moral values, and not a single falsehood had been uttered from these companions. This verse of Zend Avesta again speaks about the beloved prophet calling him as Astavit Areta, the praising one. Translated to Arabic means Ahmad, peace be upon him. And it speaks about his companions, the Sahabas, which says that they will fight against the evil. They will be well thinking, well seeing, well hearing, well behaving, will have good moral values, and they will not utter a single falsehood. There are even prophecies in the Dasatir, that the Parsi scriptures, about the advent of a beloved prophet. It says that when the Zoroastrians, the followers of Zoroaster, when they go away from the teaching of the prophet and will become dissolute, there will be a person who will arise along with his companions, who will subjugate the Persians, who will defeat the arrogant Persians. And these followers, they will not worship the fire, but will face towards the Kaaba, the house of Abraham, peace be upon him, which will be free from all the idols. And these people will be a mercy to the whole of humankind. They will rule the land, the sacred land of the Parsis, that is Persia, Bas and Talkand. And this man will be eloquent and generous. This prophecy fits to no one but a beloved prophet, Muhammad, peace be upon him, and speaks about the Sahabas, who stopped the fire worship and prayed towards the house of Ibrahim alayhi salam while they offered the prayers. If you further read in the Bandaish Yasht, chapter number 60, verse number 627, it says that Soshian will be the last prophet. That means the praiseworthy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, will be the last prophet, which is the same thing mentioned in Surah Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 40, which says, Khatamun Nabiyeen, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the seal of the prophets. Let's analyze the prophecy of the beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Buddhist scriptures. If you read the Buddhist scriptures, that is Chakravarti Sinnat Sultana, D111-76, it gives the prophecy of a Maitri. And this prophecy is repeated in most of the sacred scriptures of the Buddhists. It says that there will be coming a Buddha by the name of Maitri, who will be a holy one, a supreme one, the enlightened one, endowed with knowledge, will have wisdom, will be auspicious, will have knowledge of the universe, will receive eternal law, supreme knowledge. He will preach a religion which will be glorious at the beginning, at the climax, and at the goal. He will preach the religion of truth, same as the Buddha. But this Maitri will have thousands of followers, while Buddha has only hundreds. This prophecy is further repeated in the sacred books of the East, that this Buddha who will come by the name of Maitri, he will have thousands of followers, while present Buddha has only hundreds. It's also repeated in the Gospel of Buddha by Taras, page number 217 and 218. Now, if you analyze the word Maitri, it means a beneficent one, a merciful one, a person who's kind, who's loving, who's merciful. And one Arabic equivalent word for Maitri is Rahmat. And our beloved Prophet, the Holy Quran mentions in Surah Al-Anbiya, chapter 21, verse number 107, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةٍ لِلْعَالَمِينَ, that we have sent thee not but as a mercy to the whole of humankind. And every chapter of the Holy Quran, except for Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, begins with a beautiful formula, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. And the word mercy is mentioned in the Holy Quran no less than 409 times. So this Maitri, which the prophecy speaks about, refers to no one but our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Further, if you read in the Buddhist scriptures, in Mahaparinibbana, chapter number 2, verse number 32, which is also mentioned in the sacred books of the East, volume number 11, page number 36, it says that the Buddha will not differentiate his teachings between exoteric and esoteric. The Buddha should speak the truth, and should not have, his knowledge should not be like a closed fist of the teacher. That means whatever he teaches should not be something which is partly open and partly closed. And we know our beloved Prophet spoke about the Holy Quran in public. And even today, the Holy Quran is recited in public. And he said that none of the Muslims should hide the teaching of the Holy Quran from the other human beings. If you further read in Mahaparinibbana Sultana, chapter number 5, verse number 36, in the sacred books of the East, volume number 11, page number 97, it says that as the Buddha had a servitor by the name of Ananda, so will the Buddha Maitri to come will also have a servitor. And the servitor of the beloved Prophet was Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, who was given by his parents, his mother and father, to the Holy Prophet at the age of 8. And the Prophet called him as his beloved son, or the beloved little one. And Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, he stayed by the Prophet at the time of war and peace, even in good times as well as bad times, till the end of his life. And even during the battle of Uhud, even at the age of 11, he stood by the Prophet and protected the Prophet when he was surrounded by the enemies. Even in battle of Hunain, when the archers fired at the Prophet, he was there to protect the Prophet. You can very well compare him to Ananda, who even when the mad elephant rushed at Buddha, Ananda stood by Buddha. Further, if you read the Gospel of Buddha by Carus, page number 214, it gives six criteria for the Maitri. And all these six criteria fit perfectly to our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It says that he will receive enlightenment at night. When he receives enlightenment, he will be lit up. He will die a natural death. He will die at night time. And we know Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, said that when the Prophet was dying, there was no oil in the lamp, and she borrowed oil from the neighbor, indicating that the Prophet died during night time. Point number 5 says that when the Maitri will die, he will again be lit up. He'll become bright. And last is, once he dies in the physical form, he will never appear in the physical form in this world, which refers to no one but our beloved Prophet. There are several prophecies. If you further read, in the Dhamma Padda, Sacred Books of the East, volume 10, page number 67, it says that the Tathagatas, that means the Buddhas, they are only preachers. And the Holy Quran says, in Surah Ghashiya, chapter 88, verse number 21, it says, فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ. For your job is to deliver the message. The job of the messenger was only to deliver the message. His job was not to convert the people. Same Dhamma Padda, Sacred Books of the East, volume number 10, page number 67, says that the criteria for attaining salvation is righteousness, which is similar to as mentioned in the Holy Quran in Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1-3, which says, Wal as, innal insana lafi khusr. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَآمِنُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. That by the token of time, man is verily in a state of loss, except those who have faith, those who have righteous deeds, those who exhort people to truth, that is to dawah, and those who exhort people to patience and perseverance. These are the minimum four criteria for a person to enter Jannah according to the Holy Quran, and one of them is righteousness. Let's discuss the prophecies of a beloved Prophet in the Jewish and the Christian scriptures. Before we discuss that, I would like to relate to you an incident which took place between Reverend Paul Fender and Maulana Rahmatullah Karanvi before we got independence. Reverend Paul Fender asked Maulana Rahmatullah Karanvi to have a debate. The Maulana said that I don't know English, I only know Urdu. So after a few months, Paul Fender, he learned Urdu and said, okay, now I know Urdu, let's have a debate in Urdu. So during the debate, Paul Fender said that why don't you start? So Maulana Sahib said, since you are our guest, you should start first. So Reverend Paul, he said that, is your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is he dead or alive? So Maulana Sahib said that spiritually he's alive, he's Hayatul Nabi, but physically he's dead, he's buried in Medina. The next question the Reverend asked, that where is your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, now? So the Maulana thought for a while and said that he is next to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannat al-Firdaus. The Reverend asked the next question, where was your Prophet during the battle of Karbala? So the Maulana gave the same reply, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannat al-Firdaus. So Maulana asked the next question, where was he when his grandsons Hussein and Hassan, may Allah be pleased with them, when they were being martyred in Karbala, where was the Prophet? So Maulana paused for a while and then said that he was with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannat al-Firdaus. So the Reverend asked the next question, when your Prophet was with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with God Almighty, when his grandsons were being killed, why didn't he request, why didn't he tell God Almighty to save his grandsons? So there was a long pause. Maulana Sahib was silent. And the Muslim audience thought, Maulana Sahib gay, now he's gone. What will he answer? There was a long pause. So the Reverend said, Maulana Sahib, why don't you answer? Why didn't your Prophet tell God Almighty to save his grandsons when he was with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? After a long pause, the Maulana said. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cried. The reverend said, what? Allah cried? He said, yes. Allah said, when I could not save my own son from the cross, how will I save your grandsons? This is battle of wits. The Holy Quran says, speak with hikmah. قُدُوا إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْزَةِ الْحَسْنَةِ وَجَادِلُمْ بِاللَّتِيَ أَحْسَنِ It is invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. This is a battle of wits. When someone corners you, you should use your hikmah. Though this is not the right answer, but he used his hikmah to turn the tables over. So let's discuss the prophecy of a beloved prophet in the Jewish and the Christian scriptures. The Holy Bible is divided into two parts, the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament deals with the stories of all the prophets that came before Jesus, peace be upon him. And the New Testament deals with the life of the messenger, Jesus, peace be upon him. If you read the Holy Bible of the Catholics, the dual version, it has got 73 books. If you read the other edition, Good News Bible, it has 81 books. But the main Dawood version has got 73 books. The Bible of the Protestants has only 66 books. They say that 7 books from the Old Testament, they are apocryphal. They apocryphi. The masses of the people don't understand the meaning of apocryphi. It means doubtful. So therefore the Protestant Christians, they don't believe in these 6 books. So the Old Testament of the Catholics contains 46 books. The Old Testament of the Protestants, it contains 39 books. The New Testaments of both contain 27 books. The Holy Quran says in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 157, that the Jews and Christians, they follow a messenger, the unlettered prophet, which is mentioned in the law and the gospel. So if you read the Old Testament, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 18, it says, God Almighty says, that I shall raise thee up a prophet from among thy brethren, like unto thee, and I shall put my words into his mouth, and he shall speak all that I command him. If you ask the Christian that who does this prophecy refer to, he will say it refers to Jesus, peace be upon him. And to make it fit Jesus, peace be upon him, he will say that see, since Moses, peace be upon him, was a prophet, even Jesus, peace be upon him, was a prophet. Since Moses, peace be upon him, was a Jew, even Jesus, peace be upon him, was a Jew. So this prophecy fits to no one but Jesus, peace be upon him. The prophecy says he should be like Moses. If these two are the only criteria that the person should be a prophet and should be a Jew, then all the prophets mentioned in the Bible after Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, like Solomon, Ezekiel, Isaiah, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, John the Baptist, may peace be upon them all these prophets fulfilled the prophecy because all were Jewish and all of them were prophets of God Almighty. In fact, if you analyze, this prophecy fits to no one better than our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, because Moses, peace be upon him, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, both of them, they had mother and father. Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, was born miraculously, without any male intervention. He only had a mother, he had no father. So Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is more like Moses, peace be upon him. And Jesus, peace be upon him, is unlike Moses, peace be upon him. Both Moses and Muhammad, peace be upon them, they were married and had children. According to the Bible, Jesus, peace be upon him, was not married, neither did he have any children. Both Moses and Muhammad, peace be upon them, they died a natural death. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, according to the Holy Quran, he was raised up alive. According to the false reading of the Bible, they say he was crucified on the cross. Anyway, he did not die a natural death. Both Moses and Muhammad, peace be upon them, they bought new laws. Jesus, peace be upon him, bought no new law. It's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5, verse number 17, that think not I have come to destroy the law and the prophets. I have come not to destroy, but to fulfill. So according to the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says that he brought no new law. Moses and Muhammad, peace be upon them both, besides being prophets of God Almighty, they were even worldly kings. Worldly kings mean, if they wanted, they could give any other human being the punishment of death. They were worldly kings. This was not the case with Jesus, peace be upon him. Both Moses and Muhammad, peace be upon them, they were accepted by the people as a whole later on. But Jesus, peace be upon him, it's mentioned in the Gospel that, in the Gospel of John, he approached his own and his own forsook him. That means his own did not accept him. So if you analyze, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is more like Moses, peace be upon him. And Jesus, peace be upon him, is unlike Moses, peace be upon him. This prophecy fits to no one but our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And further says that I shall put my words into his mouth and he shall speak all that I command him. And we know that the Holy Quran was a revelation given to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, through Archangel Gabriel. And whatever was revealed to him, he repeated it verbatim, as though words were put in his mouth. And the next verse of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 19, says that if anyone does not hearken unto my words, I shall require it of him. One particular version says, I shall take revenge. That means any person who believes in the Bible, who does not hearken unto the words of this prophet, Muhammad, peace be upon him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take revenge from him. It further mentioned in the Old Testament, in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 29, verse number 12, that when the book will be given to the prophet, and when he'll be asked to read, he will say that, I am not learned. And we know that when the first revelation came to our beloved prophet, when Archangel Gabriel said, Ikra, our beloved prophet replied, Ma ana bekhare, Ma ana bekari, which means, I am not learned. This prophecy, again, fits to no one but our beloved prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Even the name of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is mentioned by name in the Holy Bible, in the Old Testament. It's mentioned in the book of Solomon, chapter number 5, verse number 16. The Hebrew quotation is, Hikko mamitakim vikulli muhammadim zahdudi wa zahrai baina Jerusalem. It's a Hebrew quotation which says, Hikko mamitakim vikulli muhammadim. The word Muhammad, to it is added im, because in the Hebrew language, if you give respect to anyone, im is added. Like how you have elo for God, you say Elohim. It's a respect. Same to the word Muhammad is added im, Muhammadim, peace be upon him. So in the original Hebrew text of the Old Testament, Song of Solomon, chapter number 5, verse number 16, our beloved prophet is mentioned by name. But the translation says that he is most sweet, he is altogether lovely. The Hebrew word Muhammadim has been translated into altogether lovely. He is most sweet, he is altogether lovely. He is my friend, he is my beloved, O daughters of Jerusalem. But in the original text, the word Muhammadim is there. Let's discuss the prophecies in the Christian scriptures. All the prophecies that are mentioned in the Old Testament of the Bible are also to be followed by the Christians. In addition to the Old Testament, they also believe in the New Testament. The Holy Quran says in Surah Saf, chapter number 61, verse number 5, that Jesus, peace be upon him, the son of Mary, was sent as a messenger to the children of Israel, to the Bani Israel, confirming the law that came before them and giving glad tidings of a prophet to come, whose name shall be Ahmad, peace be upon him. The Holy Quran says in Surah Saf, chapter number 61, verse number 6, that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, Prophet Ahmad, peace be upon him, will be prophesied in the scriptures of the Christians. Besides he being mentioned in the Old Testament, he is also prophesied in the New Testament. It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 16. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, that I shall pray to my Father, to God Almighty, to send you another Comforter who will abide with you forever. The Gospel of John, chapter number 15, verse number 26 says that when this Comforter will come to you, who will be sent by my Father, he will glorify me. He will testify me. It's further mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 7, that nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter shall not come. For if I depart, shall I send him. Now if you analyze in the Greek, original Greek manuscript that you have, the word used is parakletos. It's actually a corrupted form of the original word perikletos, which if you translate means the praiseworthy or the praising one. If you translate into Arabic, means Muhammad or Ahmed, peace be upon him. So in the original manuscript, in the original Greek, perikletos means Ahmed or Muhammad, peace be upon him. Even if you agree that it is not perikletos, it's parakletos, the exact translation is not comforter, it means an advocate or a friend. But irrespective whether the Christian, whether they say it's perikletos or parakletos, whether it is praiseworthy or praising one, or the kind one, or comforter, or advocate, alhamdulillah, all these meanings fit our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The Christian may say that this comforter, which the Bible refers to, is the Holy Spirit. It does not refer to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So you have to remind them. The prophecy says in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 7, that nevertheless I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter shall not come. For if I depart, shall I send him. That means the criteria for the Comforter to come is that Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, should go away. And the Holy Spirit which the Christians speak about was already there before Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, came. It was there in the womb of Elizabeth. It was there when Jesus Christ was being baptized, peace be upon him. So surely it cannot refer to the Holy Spirit, and it only refers to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. There are several prophecies. It further mentions the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14, that I have yet many things to say unto you. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says that I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truths. He shall tell you things to come. He shall glorify me. This Spirit of truth which the Holy Bible speaks about is no one but a beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The prophecy of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is very clearly given even in the New Testament. And the Holy Quran says in Surah Ahqaf, chapter number 46, verse number 10, that tell to the people that see you not that this is a book from God Almighty, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you reject it. Even after a witness from amongst you, from amongst the Ahli Kitab, testifies to its similarity with the early scriptures. He was a believer. But you are arrogant, and Allah guides not the unjust people. The prophecy, the Holy Quran says that, don't you see that this is a book from God Almighty, the Holy Quran, and you non-Muslims reject it, whether it be the Hindus, whether it be the Parsis, whether it be the Buddhists, whether it be the Jews, whether it be the Christians, it says, this book is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a witness from amongst you has already testified to its similarities about the prophecy of beloved Prophet, and you reject it. The witness from amongst you was a believer, and you are arrogant people. You are unjust, and Allah guides not the unjust people. I would like to end my talk by quoting a verse of the Holy Quran from Surah Al-Kawthar, chapter number 108, verse number 1 to 3, which says, Inna a'tayna al-kawthar fasalli li rabbika wanhar inna sha'niyaka wal abtar, which means that we have granted thee, that is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the fount of abundance. Jannah, the fount of abundance. So turn to thy Lord in prayer and sacrifice. And anyone who hated thee, that is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he will be cut off from all future hope. Wa akhiru da'wana, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.